to start. Good. Thank you all for gathering today. Our topic today is art and empathy. I know that earlier this fall, as the adult forum team met and we talked about things that we thought were important this year, one of the things that continued to come up was compassion and empathy and those themes, those kind of Christian themes. And my friend Chris Rackley is here. He is a local artist. He just did an installation in Virginia, a big team installation at an art gallery there. He's been in Boston. He has been featured at the Rochester Art Center in the last couple of years. And he is a guy who puts art and science and faith and all kinds of deep philosophical things that I often don't know what he's talking about together in images. And he is he's going to be sharing how art and empathy play together today. So let's welcome him.
So does it make sense if I stand here so I can touch the scroll?
Do you want me to?
No. Yeah, but then I have to say, go forward. If I stay here, am I blocking anybody's view? Oh, well. My friend Wayne, I can stand in front of him.
I'll make fun of you later.
Okay, we'll do that. I might do this because I teach, and I find that it sort of interrupts the flow if I have to say, next slide, next slide. So if it becomes obnoxious that I'm blocking your view, just tell me down in front, and I can move. So I'm Chris Rackley. Thanks for coming, especially those of you who don't know me. Appreciate you showing up. I thought I would introduce my work a little bit and then try to get to this topic. I suppose I should probably not stand in front of the projector. When was somebody going to tell me that? You were going to. All right. So, empathy. That ability, our ability to kind of see the world through somebody else's eyes and not just intellectually, but to actually feel it, to feel as they feel. Understand their position to such a degree that you can actually, you know, imagine yourself experiencing the world as they might. And art offers that a unique opportunity to do that because it's, I think, the one medium that literally shows you how someone else sees the world because you see, they give you a picture or an object through which to see. I thought I would just introduce my work a little bit. I'm a painter in training and background, and that's what I was doing primarily until I went to graduate school. I'm interested in myths and stories and scientific explanations of the origins of things, and I'm very attracted to spectacle and the presentation of the sublime in science fiction, and I really like in science fiction the sort of machinery that goes behind the way images are constructed. So I've been working with that, those ideas and paintings for a while. Then I went to grad school a few years ago, and I was enticed into the world of video. And so now I combine painting and video by using small spy cameras connected to televisions. And so the television will, yes.
Would it work better if you sat down?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Now we can't see you.
That's okay, you don't need to see me. I'm here to show some art, so this is perfect. So there's a spy camera connected to the television. You can see the television is actually just reproducing what you can see there, the painting that I made. It's a 5x6 foot painting. Then there's a set of instructions that prompt you to stand in front of the painting. And there's a small reproduction of a piece of the painting there on that stand. And this young fellow here is demonstrating. And then here's me demonstrating it. But then it appears as though you're actually inside the crater once you stand in front of the camera. So it's I've been working with ways to try to get people to perform and to play in a gallery space. I found that in galleries and museums, people walk in and they behave almost as though they're in a church. They're very quiet and solemn and very serious. So I try to disrupt that. I had another piece that literally, that had a baking soda, and by after the month, the show was up. The baking soda was all over the gallery floor and leaking out into the hallways, and it was a very proud moment for me. All right. So I wanted to start with this image and take us to the Renaissance, because this is the origin of a way of looking at things that is deeply embedded in the way we see the world now. It still informs the way that we look at the world. And so this is an image of the Holy Trinity. There's actually God the Father is on the top. What appears to be a white collar is actually a dove. So the Holy Spirit, and then Jesus below. And then to the left there is Mary, and to the right is John. And then down below, the other two figures are the donors. So these are the folks who paid and commissioned the artist to make the work. This is Masaccio, and I have to look at my notes to see dates. 1427. This painting is one of the first to use linear perspective. Actually, I want to show a close-up here of Mary before I get to that. But notice the face. I want to come back to her. The look on her face. Down below at the bottom of the painting is a kind of tomb, sarcophagus with a skeleton, and a Latin inscription that says, "As I am now, so you shall be. As you are now, so once I was." But back to this idea of linear perspective. So if you look at the ceiling, you see that there are the coffers, the recession, the part of the ceiling there. If you notice, they all converge down, apparently to a single point. The sarcophagus also appears to converge towards a single point. So what's happening here is this artist is using a mathematical system to try to represent architecture. And I like to explain this as, imagine that you know, when you go to the movies, for me it was Jurassic Park. The first time you see special effects done in such a realistic way, it just, you can't believe what you just saw. I think this painting had that kind of effect. When people walked into the cathedral, this is in Florence in Santa Maria Novella, when they walked in, I think that's that kind of experience, that they saw a kind of realism they had never seen before. It looked like it was actually there. And this is the concept that I want us to work with today, and that's that art can be seen as a window. And here, what the artist is doing is, in a way, creating this portal into the wall and making it look as though there's actually a chapel, right, through the portal. It's kind of humorous when you consider that the donors commissioned the artist to do this because they could not afford a real chapel, right? So they hired the artist to paint one that looks like a chapel. But this was still used in the same way that a small chapel would have been used. It's not there now, but there was a small altar and kneelers, candles. You could come and prayers were said, the family would come, other people could come, and it was actually intended as a devotional space in the same way that a physical chapel would have been, but it's just an illusion. But this is the beginning of looking at particularly paintings as a window, as a portal into something else that isn't actually there. And in this case, what we're seeing is a spiritual reality. Something that's not actually outside the building or part of the building, but it's a reality that can't be seen with the eyes. So the artist is giving us that. This idea of the window is still a topic that artists are interested in. I'm skipping way ahead now. This is René Magritte. This is actually in the Minneapolis Institute of Arts. If you'd like to go and see it, it's quite beautiful. Painted in 1955. But he's sort of a goofball in a way, because he's taking this idea, begun in the Renaissance, of the painting being a window. And he's painted a window. But in front of the window is another painting of what's outside the window. So there's just this sort of delicious circular loop that Magritte was famous for. But this idea of painting being a portal into something else is very powerful and continues to inform what artists do. So I'm going to take us now to Rembrandt, This is a painting that he made in 1629. This is also, interestingly, it's a painting of another painting. This is the Rembrandt painting himself when he was 23 years old, just at the beginning of his career. And you can see him there, sort of in the corner, with the tools of his trade. He's got, it's a bit difficult to see, but he's got a stick across his chest. It's called a maul stick. That's a stick you can place against the canvas so you can rest your arm without, so you don't mess up the paint. He's got his brushes, of course, and Rembrandt was known for kind of his flamboyancy and his accumulation of costumes. He was obsessed with costumes, and so he's, instead of wearing the kind of working artist clothing you might expect, he's actually decked out in sort of a, you know, whatever he felt like wearing that day. I like to point out the canvas here. We don't know what the picture it is he's painting, but it could be he's painting the picture, you know, the canvas depicted is the image we're seeing. So, the other thing I want to point out is with Rembrandt, one of his interests was in this kind of naturalistic light. This was another step in the direction of representing the world in a very realistic way. And so the light here is coming from probably a window. Although he's sneaky in a way, the way he's painted this, if you look at this, it almost looks as though it's his own painting that's giving off the light. And he's sort of standing back, basking in the glow of some kind of, you know, a revelation of sorts. And there again is that kind of flip, is the painting itself is a window, but there's actually probably a real window giving off the light. And this, I want to kind of transition to the idea of the window is not the illusion we look through, but also more metaphorically, the window into what the artist is thinking or how the artist is feeling. So this is Rembrandt at 23. This is Rembrandt at 63. This is actually, I think this is the last self-portrait that he painted. Some things I wanted to point out were, now it's just Rembrandt. We don't know what room he's in. If you look at his hands, which you can barely see at the bottom right, they are barely visible. They're no longer holding anything. His workspace is absent. The labor of his life is absent. All we're left with is just him. And the way he makes these images, obviously, is he's staring into a mirror. And one of the things I love about self-portraiture is that feeling you get when you stand in front of one of these paintings and you realize where you stand is where the artist once was. And in a way, it kind of harkens back to that first image we looked at with the skeleton lying down and the text saying that what I am now, you will be. A self-portrait almost always functions in that way because a self-portrait is always this glimpse into the past. And you physically stand in the space the artist stood when the artist was painting the picture.
Question?
Yes.
So is it a mirror image or is he corrected it when he paints it?
That's a great question. I don't know. I know that when I do self-portraits myself, I don't correct it. In part because it's sort of, well, I'm not going to tell you my reasons, but yeah, I don't know. That's actually a really good question. I also have a mark on my face that's easy to tell when the image has been flipped, so I don't know about Rembrandt. The other thing about Rembrandt's life at this point is that he had lost his wealth. He at one time was quite wealthy on his commissions, but at this point was essentially bankrupt, but still funded by patrons who were fans of his work and still supported him, but he was, had lost the wealth that he had had and had lost at least one wife. I'm trying to remember if he'd had a second. Anybody remember that? But he had lost, his first wife had passed away. And so this is an image of a man confronting his own mortality and staring just at that, his own beingness. And one of his patrons remarked that at this point in his life, Rembrandt was using so much paint on the canvas, piling the paint so high that you could actually pick the painting up by the nose. And this is, yes, he's almost sculptural, yes. And this is the two side by side. I'm going to do a similar thing here with another artist, a contemporary artist. This is Chuck Close. This is a painting of Chuck Close when he was 28, at the beginning of his career. This painting is massive. Here's Chuck Close standing beside his painting. This is at the Walker, so if you have a chance to get there, I would recommend you go and take a look. It will knock you off your feet. It is just impressive in its scale. And his illusionism, again, that kind of what we saw at the beginning in the Renaissance and with Rembrandt, that kind of representing this the world in a very hyper-realistic way. So Chuck Close is really taking it to an extreme. When you look closely at this portrait, you're going to see he has carefully painted every, you know, stubble, every pore, every blemish. He even paints camera blur. So Chuck Close works from photographs, directly from a photograph. He takes the picture, he grids it, and then numbers the grid, and then on a large canvas recreates the grid, and then piece by piece fills in each square as he sees it in the photograph. And he's very faithful to the way the photograph presents reality, and photographs will blur things that are out of focus. So in his paintings, you'll notice blur. This is an image of Chuck Close working on, this is more recent, he's become much more colorful in the last couple of decades. He was in an accident that's left him paralyzed, and so he uses a wheelchair, and his right hand, I'm not exactly sure how much use he has, but he does have a kind of prosthetic that he developed so that he can hold the paintbrush and still do his work. And oh, you know, this is, I wish I had a better picture, but he has this amazing, this is, I'm a little jealous because I want this for myself, but he has this system where his studio is on the second floor and the painting, so that he, because he can't raise himself up and down, so he found a way, he has a motorized system that raises the painting up and down, but in order to get to the very top of the painting, you know, as you can see, it's tall. The painting, there's actually a hole in the floor, so the painting lowers through the floor so that he can get to the top of the painting. But he's worked this way for many years, filling in the squares. He's a little more paint, what we would say painterly now. You know, you can see things are a bit looser. And when I talk about Chuck Close, especially to high school students, they often complain, well, isn't the grid a kind of trick and a cheat? Shouldn't he be doing it freehand? And I point to this. If you look closely at Mary here, this is that Renaissance painting, you're going to actually see there's a grid. And that grid is, Masaccio would have painted directly on the wall, and that was a fresco, meaning basically plaster, wet plaster. While the plaster's wet, you would actually paint into the plaster, and the plaster, when it hardens, holds the paint. Very sturdy. It's one of the reasons those paintings are still around, is because they're very strong. But before the painting begins, he would put a bit of wet plaster and actually inscribe marks, so that he would know where he's going to put the painting later. And those grids, when you look, are actually still there. If they would let you touch it, you could feel them, but you would get into some trouble if you did. So back to Chuck Close. This is pretty recent. This is 2015, 2016. Chuck Close is now 76 years old. I just want to take a little closer look at this. He's still working with the grid. And he's now using an approach where he layers paint. So each square probably has 5 to 10 or 15 layers of paint, almost as though you're layering sheets of colored glass on one another. Artists like to do that because the light actually passes through those layers of paint, hits the white canvas, and bounces back out. So it actually does give it a glow that isn't really apparent from a digital image. But I want to look at these two images the same way we did with Rembrandt. The first is Chuck Close at 28. This new one is him at 76. There was a really interesting article in the New York Times Magazine by Will Hilton. And I wanted to read you a quote. It's a little bit lengthy, but I think it's good. He's talking, he has been following Chuck Close and was talking to Chuck Close and was looking at Chuck Close's newest paintings and was actually kind of struck by this sudden difference in the way these two, the beginning of his career between and what he's doing now. So this is what he says. It seems to me now, with greater reflection, that the value of experiencing another person's art is not merely the work itself, but the opportunity it presents to connect with the interior impulse of another. The arts occupy a vanishing space in modern life. They offer one of the last lingering places to seek out empathy for its own sake. And to the extent that an artist's work is frustrating or difficult or awful, you could say this allows greater opportunity to try to meet it. I'm not saying there's no room for discriminating taste and judgment, just that there is also, I think, this other portal through which to experience creative work and to access a different kind of beauty, which might be called communion. Some of the context for what he's talking about here is that Chuck Close is experiencing apparently a kind of crisis. He was married for 43 years. He is filing for divorce. He has left his beautiful studios in New York and has moved to Miami. He's begun wearing really garish and outlandish clothing. He doesn't speak to his children. And this article was kind of an investigative piece about trying to understand what's going on. What is this man doing now? And ultimately, the author doesn't have an answer to those questions. But I think that's his statement about the compassion and the empathy and the communion, is the attempt to try to understand what even seems like Chuck Close making a very rash and hurtful decisions with his close relationships. The other thing that this author points out is that this is the first portrait that Chuck Close has done without his eyeglasses on. There's some, I think, vulnerability that Chuck Close is expressing by removing that. And then I also wanted to just point out, just visually, how similar the Rembrandt portrait and Chuck Close portrait look. When you think about the two images of two men, the face only lit coming out of this darkness, especially when both of them had previously done paintings that were very much full of light, this is quite a change. I'm going to move on to sculpture. This is a little bit outside of my expertise. I'm much more, know more about painting, but I think this is exquisite. This is Ron Muick. He has a background in puppetry and worked for Jim Henson's company for a while before becoming an artist. Close up here. This is all made out of fiberglass. When you look closely at the face, this again is a kind of continuation, even of Chuck Close, is that hyperrealism, this kind of way of looking at the world very closely, almost with scientific precision. But every pore, every eyebrow is punched in with a single hair. All of the, you know, the redness of the eyes that she may have been crying, that's painted. And there's actually, you know, some glistening down here around her nostrils. But as amazing as the details are, what's really striking about this piece is its size. This is the docent sitting next to the sculpture. The piece is very, it's titled In Bed. And another patron here. And like Chuck Close, one of the things that Ron Muick is playing with is the scale. When you change the scale of something, the way it affects us can be very striking. And so this is apparently stumbling upon a moment of intimacy from which this person cannot hide because they're too big. whatever pain they're experiencing can't be hidden, even if they wanted to. It's on display for us. It's quite uncomfortable to see this in person. And I'm going to switch. This is going to feel like a bit of a switch here. This is a local artist, Minnesota artist. This is Carl Unash. He actually, he works with glass and large-scale sculpture. He has a sculpture actually in front of the Rochester Arts Center. It's a large matchstick that's burnt at the top, and if you go and visit it at night, it actually, the lit part glows. It's quite beautiful. But he has a background in stained glass. So he did this project where he took an old combine and actually almost turned it into a cathedral. He's fitted it with, I believe, 34 separate pieces of stained glass, and it's illuminated from within. Yeah. And some of the close-ups of the images. He's also quite playful and clever. The image there on the right is teeth eating corn. So the idea that he was playing with eating, the way the combine eats the harvest, the way people consume food, the way the food chain works. So he's got an image of a termite there on the left. He's got an image of a baby chewing on crayons. But all images of consumption. And these are images that honor the tools used by pioneers to make the land into something that, you know, where they could live and sustainable, so kind of a nod to the first settlers in the area. And I believe these images are actually taken from a book that was an illustration of the wide variety of tools that were developed. This one is, the bottom here on the left is a corn husk doll, so a nod to a time when you would need, you know, when toys could be made from anything you had on hand. And then a nice little kind of geeky art reference here. This is a reference to a Thomas Hart Benton painting, who was a painter of the Midwest and often featured American laborers in his images. It looks like maybe I have time for one more. This is a little bit self-serving. I'm going to talk about it. This is the project that I just did in Virginia. This is going to look very different than the work I showed you at the beginning. This is collaborative work that I do with a mentor of mine from graduate school. He and I found that we very much admire Baroque art for very different reasons. And he and I have been collaborating on some projects for a few years now. And the show in Virginia was an exhibition of several projects we've done together. So this presentation, for this project, I did drawings directly on the wall, and Edgar showed some photographs he had made for this project previously, which is around shoeshiners in Bolivia. Mm. And this is a project that he became interested in a few years ago, and it's in the 80s, there was an economic collapse when the price of tin dropped. And a lot of young professionals in La Paz had to find work as shoe shiners. But in Bolivian culture, this is seen as a very shameful kind of work. And so they begin wearing masks, essentially, to protect their identity. And Edgar did this beautiful project where he commissioned a local artist from La Paz to create a mask that has sort of semi-Catholic imagery, but also images of the shoeshiner's tools, and with gold embroidery. And he invited shoeshiners to actually wear the mask around town. And it's not in this image, but they were actually followed by a band. So it became this kind of, small festival and celebration of the dignity of the work that these young professionals do. And when he invited me to do the project, I draw, I'm a painter, so I contributed a set of drawings. So I made images that are kind of based on some of the flying angels from the Sistine Chapel, and took images of the shoe shiners and had them, maybe this one's a little bit better, but flying. The other important part for me that I was interested in this project is that my father is a shoe salesman, has been a manager of a shoe store to this day. And I grew up in a shoe store in the back room, and which is where I actually think that I received my artistic training, because like the corn husk doll, I had a lot of time to use what was at hand, which was cutting up the cardboard, using the back of the invoice forms to draw, and creating my sci-fi worlds in that context. And so this project in a way was interesting to me because it felt like a way. Actually, this image is the one. This one I sort of felt like was, I drew the image, and then I photographed it and sent it to my dad. Because it feels like, in a way, I'm trying to honor the dignity of what he does, what he has done for me. And this is sort of a, you know, I'm not very good at saying I love you, you know, sort of man to man. But I can do it through a picture, so I sent him this.
Did he get it?
Yes. He did. He said some very kind words that it was really nice. It was very nice. And maybe I have time for one more? Okay. This is artwork that's on view right now at the Rochester Arts Center that I would highly recommend that you go and see. It's a short video. It's 1 minute. I'll just let you have a look, and then we can say some things. Note the text there, let's be friends. So that's a work by Rory Wakeemup. Let's see if I can get good. There we go, to show the full image. He is an artist and director of All My Relations, which is a gallery of contemporary art for Native American art in Minneapolis. And the project here is part of an ongoing series that he developed as a statement about the appropriation of Native American imagery by sports teams. And originally the project was called Kill the Idiot, Save the Fan. Which I believe is a play on a slogan from the Carlisle School, which was a government-funded boarding school for Native Americans. And the slogan then was, kill the Indian, save the man. So Rory Wakeemup has taken that, appropriated it, and owned it in a powerful way. The mirrored surfaces you see in the background are shields with mirrored surfaces that he and a group of artists made to use actually at the South Dakota protest. So those were actually used and then brought back and placed on the wall. And I think I want to end with this because as much as I want to advocate for art as a window, and the many ways that it can be to show us things that we can't see, but also metaphorically to give us insight into what someone else is feeling, to hopefully help us empathize and feel what they feel, sometimes art can work like a mirror. Sometimes it reflects back to us what we already believe to be true and our own fears. And sometimes it takes work to actually begin again to see it as a window. And one of the things I like about Wakeemup's presentation here is that when you confront these figures, that we recognize Darth Vader and the Stormtrooper, but we're also confronted with our own image in those mirrored surfaces. And And there's that small text that you almost can't see behind Darth Vader, that invitation to let's be friends. But I think it's a powerful way to kind of invite us in and to consider something that may be challenging or present us with something we're not comfortable with. So I actually got through all of the slides. So I would love it if there's some time for questions or discussion. And I really appreciate you guys being here and listening. So thank you. Yelling is good.
This will work. Let's just try.
Where can you see that Cornhusker machine that was glass?
Oh, I'm glad you asked that. It is in Wisconsin. In, make sure I get this right. Reedsburg, Wisconsin, and. So it was actually developed for a festival, but a local arts nonprofit and the community in general loved it. So the nonprofit was formed to actually purchase it for the city, and now it sits in the garden. So it's a permanent installation that's there, and it does light up at night. So as you can see from the photographs, I think it'd be nice to. I would love to plan a trip and actually see it then, because it would be that's quite beautiful.
I don't know what to make of this, but if you go back to that close image with all of the pixels, if you're near something, and remove
yes.
your glasses,
yeah.
that comes into focus better.
I'm glad that my nearsightedness finally has an advantage. Yes.
Quilters are using this technique to make huge quilts, take a pixelated image, match up the colors with the fabric, and make huge portraits.
Oh, that's interesting. Is there? Oh, yeah, look at that.
I don't know if you can focus the projector, but you could put it slightly out of focus and improve the image as well.
Well, you know, and this actually—that's actually a good point—is that the idea of improving. There is something about him purposefully wanting us to see it blurry. That's part of what he's confronting us with. The other thing that's kind of hard to—this is what I always like to try to convey to my students—is that seeing a painting as a digital image loses something. A painting is an object at the end of the day, and needs to be experienced. You have to be in front of it. So the scale is an important issue. So for Chuck Close, part of what happens when you experience it is that when you stand at kind of a normal distance to it, you can't see the face. And even with the ones where they were very photographic, when you get close, you can't see the face. So he sort of has this interesting way of almost pushing you away from the painting that that you don't really feel until you're there.
So if you were to go and see an exhibit, what are two or three of the best exhibits that you can recommend?
They're constantly changing. If you could go to New York right now and go to the Whitney Biennial, I would highly recommend that. Mm-hmm. That's always a fantastic snapshot of just the broad variety of contemporary art. Sometimes that's where, when thinking about art as a mirror or a window, sometimes when you encounter contemporary art, it can be a little challenging because they often use non-traditional materials. But it's artists who are really thinking about issues that are affecting our country and the globe right now. And the work is often very challenging and sometimes beautiful, sometimes horrific, but sometimes very beautiful, but worth a trip. So I would recommend that. I would actually recommend closer to home, though, is I would just go to the Rochester Art Center, have a look at this, and then a little farther afield, go to the Walker. There's a Merce Cunningham exhibit up right now, a retrospective that shows Merce Cunningham is a choreographer, dancer. They often collaborated with visual artists, and so that work is up now at the Walker.
I've been to the Minneapolis Institute of Art several times. I go when there's art in bloom,
mm-hmm.
and they arrange flowers and plants and to depict the
portrait. Yes. Yeah.
It's really awesome.
Yeah, it's beautiful. If you haven't heard of that, I can't remember when they do that. It's an annual.
In May.
In May. Okay.
In May.
But the Minneapolis.
Or April.
Okay.
May or April.
Springish. Yeah. And the Minneapolis Institute of Arts has done this annual event where they coordinate floral arrangements, elaborate, beautiful, that in some ways pair with the paintings and the artwork on view. So lush and fun.
I
do too.
How does the availability of materials or your encountering new materials inform how you use them? You're primarily a painter, but are you inspired by other materials or using other materials in a painterly fashion?
Yeah, I mean, I always think of materials in a way as a kind of technology, and technology always has a sort of seductive quality to it. You know, there's always, you know, sort of new paints and new for the exhibit in Virginia, for instance. I just discovered there is now a acrylic paint that behaves like an ink. And that was important because I didn't want to be mean to the curator in Virginia. If you use ink on a wall or permanent marker or something that's oil-based, it is really difficult to paint over when you're done. And I make it a point to not anger curators if I can help it. My career depends on having them think well of me. But I did some research and found there's a paint out there that's it's Liquitex and Golden both make it's called, you know, acrylic ink, but it has the same kind of fluid flow, so it feels like you're drawing with ink, but it's actually a water-based paint that can be painted over and makes my curator happy. So I don't know if that quite got at your question, but there's always new materials that
I use that in surface design on fabric.
Oh, I wish I had done these. I should have known earlier. I only just learned about it a couple weeks ago.
We were quite interested to hear what you had to say today, art and empathy, because our daughter, who was a double major, math and art, and did her math career first and is into her art career now, because we asked her, you know, how does she decide what to paint? And she said, I paint my feelings. Mm-hmm. And she had a really interesting reaction this last month. She had a woman in her gallery who was looking at the paintings and got to one and burst into tears.
Mm.
Just, she said, oh, I have to have that painting. Mm. So Linda shipped it to Texas for her, and when it arrived, the woman called her and said, as soon as I opened it, I burst into tears again. Mm. So she had an emotional reaction to whatever it was that Linda had painted. So we were interested to hear what you had to say about art and empathy.
That's incredible when that happens, isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
My hope for art is that, you know, it is like language, it is like words, it is a form of communication. I mean, and when it is one of the many ways that we try to understand one another. So when that moment happened, that is incredible.
Thank you.
Would you have a comment on that saying, art is in the eye of the beholder?
Yeah, I feel like I could say lots about that. I don't know if any of them are good things. But I mean, you know, in a way, I like the quote that I had read earlier about there. there always will be an element of taste, which I think is what that art is in the eye of the beholder is getting at, is that anything could be art or anything could be likable depending on the liker. It depends on personal taste and who can explain taste. But those of us who, when I talk to colleagues, curators and other artists and people who write and think about art a lot, we acknowledge that, but there is some sense that, some things don't work as well as others. And there may be things that I've encountered that I don't, actually there's a lot of art I would say that I've encountered that I would say I don't like, in the sense that I wouldn't want it in my house. But I understand how its ideas affect other people, or its importance in changing the way we see the world. So maybe I would say it probably is true that art is in the eye of the beholder, but I'm not sure that's the only thing we should be considering when we're talking about art, because at the end of the day, what we're trying to get at is that connection with one another. We're trying to connect. We're trying to establish that communion. And insofar as art helps that and makes it better, I feel like that's the value art has.
I'm struck today by you spent a lot of time talking about the techniques,
mm-hmm.
almost the technology of art, but that it's all in service of that emotional window, that empathy. And we can get ourselves maybe too much into the technique of it, and then we lose the overall effect of what's... just as you talked about this picture pushing you away to get farther back to see something, all that other stuff about layering paints and all that other stuff is in service of that experience.
Yes, yes.
I think that's the interesting, to me they're almost different.
I think from my mind, I know I've spoken to you a lot about, I'm a big fan of Marshall McLuhan's ideas that the medium is the message. And the idea there is that the material itself is the thing that changes the way we perceive the world, more so than the actual subject or content of the image. Chuck Close's layering creates a glow. That glow has an effect on us. That the scale, his choice to make it that size, is a confrontation. I mean, it's monumental almost on the scale of something like Stonehenge in its size and the way it imposes itself almost unbidden upon us. That way the medium is working on me in some very powerful ways. We can talk about it. The subject is Chuck Close, and it's a guy looking at himself, and it's a guy at a particular time in his life looking at himself. But some of that felt stuff and the things that I kind of walk away with really do largely come down to the materials and those aesthetic choices.
I was just going to say, as a musician, it's the same way that I teach my piano students, that their technique is what helps bring out the musicality of the piece, that you really need both. You need to try to approach it with a musical sense, but through your techniques of articulation or phrasing or whatever, you bring out that musicality. You need them both.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense to me. And I almost feel like there's a point where they're sort of inextricable. They can't be pulled apart anymore.
I have a question. An artist like Dalí, who starts out with one type of painting, and then switches his style.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have any comment about changing style or the thought? Have you studied any of the reason, the rationality?
I think they're varied. The example in art school was always, example par excellence is Picasso. Picasso could not settle down.
Yes.
you know, he begins as this, what we forget is he has incredible talent as a draftsperson, meaning ability to draw and paint.
Yeah.
But I don't even remember right now how many times Picasso changed his style, but in largely in response to ideas and things he was thinking and just tried to pursue those. I guess I don't really have an answer, but some artists definitely have a break or a kind of slipping between styles. But if medium is the message, then sometimes the thing you want to say can't be said in the medium you're using. So sometimes artists do make huge leaps because they realize, I was a painter, but what I wanted to say has to be said in time. So now I have to do it with a video because painting doesn't work with time in the same way.
Or the surreal comes to mind.
Yes.
Really,
yeah.
Yeah, you're gonna let me close?
Yeah.
Okay.
Bring her home.
Chris, thanks so much. Yeah. I was his pastor at one point, so he never said that in worship, but bring it home, bring it home. Thank you so much, Chris, for helping us to dive into these images. It's interesting, standing here and looking at that image that is up here, he is much clearer in a small image from a distance than up there, and I'm very drawn to that image. I just kind of want to look at it, and it just causes me to want to know more about what's going on in this guy's life that he looks like that. So anyway, thank you. Next.